So good afternoon everyone. Today we will be learning a little overview of the X-ray diffraction phenomenon. Okay, this is kind of a prerequisite of understanding how X-rays are used to carry out. So you know that X-rays are basically electromagnetic radiation, right? So X-rays are basically created in a cathode ray tube with a cathode, an anode here, and when the voltage is increased, the electrons are released from the cathode and impinges on anode, right? And this phenomena leads to emit X radiation, right? And this radiation is released when this cathode ray tube is under vacuum or in under argon or neon atmosphere, right? So the point is, when the X-rays are released, in order to get a characteristic X-ray, we need to Bremer-Starling X-ray, that is white X-rays, right? And you keep on increasing the intensity, and at some point you get K alpha and K beta, right? Basically we need monochromatic X-rays for any kind of diffraction. So we just take this K alpha, which has a particular lambda, right? And the start, the initial, is a short wavelength. It depends upon, this is the point where the maximum energy is being converted. You understood? So if an X-ray, an electron impinges the anode with a voltage V, then if at one shot an electron is released, the X-rays which is emitted with that electron can be given by H by mu, okay, where mu is the frequency. So you know that mu is equal to C by lambda. I hope I am fine. For the highest energy X-ray, the lambda will be minimum. And at a certain, are basically suitable to study the structure of the crystalline material. And this is because the typical wavelength of X-rays is at par with the range of the interatomic spacing of the crystal. So it should be basically smaller. You know, if the wavelength will be larger, then it will not follow the Bragg's law. Okay, so we will come to it. So you see, usually the wavelength of an X-ray is about 0.5 to 2.5 Armstrong. This makes the crystals to act like diffraction gratings, right? Based on the diffraction principles, the following can be measured in the crystalline material. One is the interplanar spacing, that is D, right? The lattice parameter. Orientation of single crystal or polycrystalline material. We can measure the size, shape, and the internal strain of small crystalline regions. We understand, we know that we can measure crystallite size, we can measure dislocation density. If there is an unknown material, we can measure the crystal structure. So let's understand what is constructive interference and destructive interference. See, if two electromagnetic waves, say wave A and wave B, are propagating in the same direction. If you see here, if both has started from a single point and is propagating in the same direction, they have traveled equal path, and then the resultant wave, that is the wave C, will be the addition of both this, right? In case both of them are in the same phase, that means that if they have traveled equal distances, then there will be constructive interference. In case if both of them have traveled different distances, then there could be a different kind of, the addition will not be fully constructive. It could be also destructive. If the two phases, the two waves are totally out of phase to each other, then there could be a destructive interference. So the differences in the length of the path travel led to differences in the phases, right? The introduction of phase difference produces a change in the magnitude. The differences in the path length of various rays arise quite naturally when considering how crystal diffraction occurs. See, basically this means that whenever an incidental electromagnetic X-rays, of course rays, X-rays are electromagnetic, it falls on a crystalline surface, and because the atomic spacing of this crystallized surface is more than the wavelength, or almost in the same range of the wavelength of this X-rays, so the X-rays basically penetrate into the material. When it scatters back, few of these X-rays coherently scatter, and they at a certain angle, and this scattering phenomena is known as diffraction. During this diffraction phenomena, few of these X-rays travel larger distance inside the crystal, few travel less distance inside the crystals. This may lead to a phase difference, and at the end, whatever the phase the X-rays are present here, depending upon that, it will undergo a constructive interference or a destructive interference, is basically an addition of two. Okay, so it could be something in between. So what I was saying is, a diffraction beam may be defined as a beam composed of large number of scattered rays mutually reinforcing each other. So I hope that you remember that as a kid we learned alpha particle scattering in a gold foil, Rutherford's experiment on scattering, right? So diffraction is a scattering phenomena, but diffraction occurs because of the periodic arrangement of the atoms in the crystalline material. So diffraction is nothing but a scattering which is occurring more coherently. It is reinforcing scattering under certain direction at certain angle because of the periodicity of the crystal, right? So therefore this phenomena is known as diffraction. So in other words, diffraction is a scattering phenomena where at some particular angle the scattered radiation forms constructive interference, arises when an electromagnetic wave interacts with the periodic structure, right? A diffraction is basically reinforced coherent scattering, fine? So here is the simple Bragg's law that I tried to describe. You see that one X-ray electromagnetic radiation is falling on this atom, another electromagnetic radiation is falling on this atom, and because of the interplanar distance d between this HKL plane and this HKL plane, the length travelled by this incident beam is more than this one, right? So one can say that the lower beam has travelled a distance which is AB plus BC times more than the upper beam. A constructive interference will take place if AB plus BC is equal to n times of lambda. And why? And this n has to be integer. Why? You see, one wave and the second wave. If there is a full two wave, for example, then in both the cases, it is in the positive side and the maxima and in the minima. So, addition of this will lead to a constructive interference, right? So, you see, if I do some mathematics, if this is d, then AB is equal to d of sin theta. So, AB plus BC is equal to 2d sin theta. And if this is equal to n lambda, where n is an integer, we get a constructive interference. On the other hand, if you see this picture here, the same picture, but if you see that we have one full, what, a phase and one half. So we have about 1, 2, 3 by 2. So n is here 3 by 2, and when it comes out, you see here is the maxima, at the same point here is the minima. So in such a case, when n is not an integer, you will get a destructive interference. So that is what is the Bragg's law. So Bragg's law is n lambda is equal to 2d sin theta. So if there is a constructive interference, there will be a diffracted X-ray beam, right? Based on this Bragg's law equation, and here there are three variables, right? Lambda, d, and theta, right? Lambda comes from the X-ray source, the monochromatic X-ray source K alpha that we found out, right? Theta, you have to measure it from the experiment, right? So there will be a certain theta for a particular HKL plane, right? So d is the planar distance between two planes, which is equal to a by h square plus k square plus l square, where a is the atomic spacing, right, the unit cell size. So one can just use this equation and introduce this equation in here to get a relationship which shows, which predicts that for a particular incident wavelength lambda and a particular cubic crystal of a unit cell A, all possible Bragg angles at which diffraction can occur from the plane HKL. So using this formula, we can find out different thetas for which the HKL plane will diffract, right? A basic diffraction, we do a theta 2 theta scan, and in this theta 2 theta scan, what we do is that we take the sample, we keep the sample. Okay, this is a very good picture. So we keep the sample, say initially horizontally like this, and here is the cathode ray tube and there is a detector. We rotate the cathode ray, we keep the cathode ray tube at the same position, we rotate the sample by theta. The detector is rotated by 2 theta, so that every time when the rays fall and if there is a diffraction, it goes to the detector following the Bragg's law. Now the point is, in this case, when the sample is rotated from theta is equal to 0 degree, where the detector is also at the 0 degree, when the sample is rotated by theta, the detector is rotating by 2 theta, what is happening is that those planes which are parallel to the surface of the sample are only getting diffracted. Okay? So, we get information of those HKL planes. So, you see a typical X-ray diffraction pattern. This is for a BCC material, and you see that when we do this theta 2 theta scan, we can plot the intensity versus 2 theta or theta, and we can get various peaks at various positions of theta, and that means that with respect to each HKL plane there is a particular theta, right. Now you see that the first intensity has formed at the plane 110. The second intensity at 200, then 211, 220, 310. There are many planes in which no intensities have developed, like 100, right. There are other planes like 111 is missing, and therefore it is not only because of the Bragg's law. If the Bragg's law is satisfied, a diffraction will take place, but there are other factors too, right. And this factor is basically known as the structure factor, right. And what does it mean, a structure factor? Structure factor basically takes into consideration the position of atoms in an unit cell. The Bragg's law doesn't consider the position of the atoms in the unit cell. For example, in case of BCC material, there is an atom which is at the center of the unit cell. In case of the FCC material, there are atoms which are at the face centered. The coherent scattering is from the atom, the group of the atom in the crystal that has a periodic arrangement, right. It is not from an isolated atom, right. So, this is all I have said actually. So, now I would like to say that how this structure factor basically affects the diffraction planes in case of BCC or FCC. In case of simple cubic, you will find that there is no missing intensities, but in case of BCC you will find that if the H plus K plus L is not even, then the intensity is 0. In case of FCC you will see that if the H or the K and the K and the L should be either all even or all odd in order to get a diffraction. So, let us see. Let us consider an orthogonal unit cell. I am drawing it two dimension. And you see that if a beam, and let us say that this is H 0 0 plane, and if the incident beam is falling at a certain angle theta, then the diffraction beam will go like this, right. If another incident beam is falling like that, now this incident beam, so if this is atom A, if this is atom B, let's say this is C and D, then this incident beam is traveling an extra path CB plus BD, right? Right? And if and this CB plus BD, you can write like CBD is equal to 2D sin theta, right? This D can be written, one second, as you know D is equal to A times H square plus 0 square plus 0 square equal to A by H, right? So if we have another atom somewhere here at a distance x, there is a beam which will fall in this atom. If this CBD is equal to lambda, then let's say E, F and G. So F, E, G, which is equal to 2 times x sin theta, should be always less than lambda, right? So the phase difference in this case, if I say the phase difference 1 by 2 delta 1 2, and if the phase difference is delta 1 3, then the phase difference, in order to understand that why few HKL planes do not diffract even if it follows the Bragg's law, it is important to understand the scattering of the X-ray by the unit cell. In this regard, we have taken an orthogonal unit cell with in a two-dimensional scale, and we are trying to find out scattering of the X-ray in the H00 plane, that is this plane. We can see that when the beam is incidenting on the atom A, it is getting diffracted like this. When the beam is incidenting on the atom C, it is again getting diffracted at the same angle theta. One can see that the path difference between these two diffracted beam is MCN. This path difference, which is delta 2 bar 1 bar, is equal to 2 times DH 0 0 sin theta, and which is should be equal to lambda. Now this DH 0 0 is equal to AC, and this AC is basically equal to A divided by root of H square plus 0 square plus 0 square. That means that is equal to A by H, whereas A is the unit distance of the unit cell. If there is an atom which is present at the fractional position, that is at a fractional coordinate, then the incidental beam and the diffracted beam will have a path difference delta 3 bar 1 bar, which is equal to RBS, and this RBS should be equal to the ratio of AB by AC times lambda. The AB, if we consider AB equal to X, then AC is A by H, then the delta 3 bar 1 bar is equal to x times lambda by A by H. We can calculate the phase difference, which is related with the path difference delta by phi is equal to delta by lambda times 2 pi. So, the phase difference between the atom which is in the fractional position is equal to the path difference divided by lambda times 2 pi, which is equal to 2 pi h x by a, where x by a is the fractional coordinate of the atom B, which can be taken as u. This analogy could be extended in 3 dimension for the fractional coordinate system x by a, y by b, z by c, which could be represented by u, v and c. In this situation, the orthogonal unit cell will look like this, and we can see the initial diffraction from the atom A here, the diffraction from the another atom here, and the diffraction from the atom which is at the fractional position here. In such a situation, the phase difference phi is equal to 2 pi times h u plus k v plus L w. This situation where the X-ray beam is being diffracted from different atoms could be observed from the intensity versus a lambda plot, or an intensity versus a 2 pi mu t plot, where mu is the frequency. You know that in each case, as the lambda is constant, therefore, the mu is also constant, because mu is equal to is a function of c by lambda. Now, you see that if for a diffracted beam A1, if this is the electromagnetic radiation, it started with a phase difference phi 1, then we can say that E1 is equal to A1 times sin 2 pi mu t minus phi 1. In case of another beam diffracted by another atom, could be given by maybe this one at a phase difference phi 2, this could be given by E2 is equal to A2 sin 2 pi mu 2 minus phi 2. The addition of these two will give the final diffraction intensity of the beam. However, this becomes quite complex to solve, and therefore, one can even use the vector relationship, whereas one diffraction is given by A1 here, another is given by A2 here. The phase difference could be given by phi 1 and phi 2, and therefore, the vector summation of the A1 and A2 could be given by A3, which has a phase difference of phi 3. It is more easier to use complex number to solve this problem, whereas where the final intensity of the diffracted beam altogether is given by A at a phase difference of phi could be denoted by A plus BI. In this situation, A is equal to A cos of phi, that is A cos of phi, that is OM, and B is equal to A sin of phi, which is OL. So, A cos of phi plus I times A sin of phi could be written as A exponential to the power I phi. This A exponential to the power I phi, where phi is the phase difference, could be written as F times, which is the atomic scattering factor, times exponential to the power 2 pi I times H u plus K v plus L w. Therefore, the structure factor for any given unit cell could be given by F is equal to F 1 epsilon to the power I phi plus F 2 plus epsilon to the power I phi plus F 3 plus epsilon to the power I phi for each atom position present in the unit cell. For the structure factor, therefore, for diffraction for a particular HKL plane could be given by the summation of all the atoms present in the unit cell, and could be given by this. The definition of structure factor is thereby equal to the amplitude of the wave scattered by all the atoms of all the of an unit cell divided by the amplitude of the I have to correct this. So the definition of the structure factor. So this rules of structure factor is basically known as the extinction rule. So it is independent of the shape and size of the unit cell, but it is dependent on the position of the atoms in the unit cell, right? So let's go ahead. If we take a single crystal, a simple cubic cell with position of atoms basically at 0, 0, 0, right? So if we put the value of 0, 0, 0 here, then it becomes so it remains F, right? So each and every Bragg's law qualified diffracted beam will means each HKL plane will be diffracted, right? In case of BCC, body centered cubic, we have an atom at the center, right? So we have an atom at U V W at 0 0 0 and another atom at half half and half, right? So you can put this value here. So we have F plus F times e to the power 2 pi I H plus K plus L, so pi I, right? Now, in this case, if H plus K plus L is equal to even, then this is equal to 1, that means it is 2 times F, and we get the diffraction. And if H plus K plus L is odd, then we get F minus F equal to 0, right? So those planes whose HKL, H plus K plus L is even will diffract, and those planes which H plus K plus L is odd will not. So which will be diffracting, right? Tell me. 1, 0, 0 will not, of course, because 1 plus 0 is 1. Then 1, 1, 0, of course, because 1 plus 1 plus 0 is 2. Then 2, 0, 0, of course, and like that. So I have given 1, 0, 0, 2, 0, 0, 2, 1, 1, 2, 2, 0, right? In case of FCC material, where the atoms are not present at the center but on the face center, right? So we have two positions, three many positions right here, 0, 0, 0, tell me, 0, half, 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 0, half, and half, half, 0, right? This many positions. Now, if we add this, we can find out that the capital F is equal to F plus F e to the power pi I H plus K plus F e to the power pi I K plus L plus F e to the power pi I L plus H, right? Right?
I hope so.
Under such situation, it was found out that a diffraction will only occur if H, K and L are all odd or all even. So based upon that, based upon the structure factor criteria, we get diffraction spots for FCC which are unmixed, means either all H, K, L are even or H, K, L are odd, right. So, you see, using this method of diffraction, we basically do a theta, 2 theta scan to find out intensities of various HKL planes corresponding to various theta, right. Now, when we get that, the Bragg peak is formed depending upon, I mean to say that a Bragg peak forms, whether it is a broadened peak or a very sharp peak, formed depending upon the material we are testing, right. If the material is fully annealed condition, then the peak is rather very sharp, right. If the material is deformed, we get a little broadening of the peak, right. Now, in ideal conditions, if there are uniform crystallite present in the material and there are no misorientations in between them, we should get an extremely sharp peak. There has to be no broadening in it. There will be no full width half maximum at all. But of course, it does not happen because instrument also has its limitation. So, there are a little broadening of peak also because of the instrument, but in ideal case, if there are no misorientations, there are no statistically stored dislocation present in it, if it is totally annealed, fully annealed, only crystallites are present, only subgrain structure is present, then we will get a very sharp peak. On the other hand, when we introduce little deformation in it, when there are formation of dislocations inside crystallites, inside even grains, then the broadening of the peak starts to occur. We actually calculate this broadening of peak in order to understand that how much fraction of dislocations are present in the material. We also try to find out what is the crystallite size. So, what I will not go into detail of that, only thing is that the crystallite size, which I already explained to you in earlier classes, that is an essentially an uniform agglomeration of crystal possessing same reflection pattern. Okay? So, you see, we can use a modified Scherer formula which can give the relationship between the crystallite size and the fixed width half maximum, full width half maximum, sorry, this. And we can find out that beta, which is the full width half maximum or the integral breadth, times cos of theta by the lambda, lambda is the wavelength of the X-ray beam, is equal to k, which is a constant depending upon the crystallite size, shape, sorry, divided by dV, which is the average crystallite size, it is a volume weighted average crystallite size, plus 4 times the microstrain E times sin theta by the lambda of the X-ray beam. So, you see, we can use X-rays in order to measure microstrain in the material, which is analogous to the dislocation density present in the material, and we can also measure the crystallite size, which is analogous to the formation of subcell subgrain structure inside the material. Okay? So, there are a few limitations, however, the crystallite size are basically less than 1000 Armstrong. There is a high error which is greater than 20% in measuring this because of the instruments. the peak broadening can be contributed by other factors like size, strain and instrument. Okay, this is the error. Okay. So, finally, I would like to show you one more thing. Which is that whenever we do find an intensity versus theta scan for a particular HKL plane, we get a peak which is something like this, right? And let us consider that this is an intensified peak, okay? And in order to obtain this peak, the d spacing should be d basically. That means it should follow lambda equal to 2d sine theta, that is the Bragg's law. And based upon that d, that is the a time h square plus k square plus l square, corresponds to the HKL plane. Right, we will have a certain theta which is this, right? The point is, if I give an uniform strain to the material so that this material elongates a little, what happens? If this material elongates a little, what will happen? What I am trying to do is that I am increasing the d spacing, right? And when I am increasing the d spacing, what is happening? Lambda is constant, so the theta is decreased, right? So under uniform strain, you get a decreased theta. If I do the same experiment, I do a little compression, so the d is shrinked, right? And under this condition, what will happen? The peak will shift here, right? On the other hand, if I give a non-uniform strain to the material, a non-uniform strain could be easily experienced if I give a small bending. Under such condition, the D is large here and small here, right? And under such condition, what will happen? Broadening of the peak will happen. A broadening of the peak basically occurs when a plastic deformation is given in the material. Under such condition, the material is under non-uniform deformed state and in a permanent deformed state, under which there are formation of large amount of dislocation density and leading to non-uniform distribution of stresses at different position in the material could be obtained from peak broadening. Okay. Principles of texture measurement by X-ray diffraction. Okay. You see that there are two types of texture which we are being taught, right? The one is the macro texture, sometimes it is known as the bulk texture. The another is the micro texture. The macro texture or the bulk texture is called such because the information about the orientation has been observed from a larger surface area, and not only from the larger surface area but from a considerable depth of the material. Okay. The micro texture, as the name suggests, is a texture obtained from a microstructure, a very small part of the sample which may sometimes be representative of the whole sample and in most of the time may not be the representative of the whole sample, because the penetration depth of the beam that determines the microstructure is very small. So, we scan just few nanometers below the surface and a very small area of the microstructure could be scanned. So, as the name suggests, global texture, this gives a complete information of the distribution of the orientation, that means the texture, and is the representative of the orientation of the whole sample. And from this we can obtain, basically macro texture is taken by X-rays, and X-rays basically give first the experimental pole figures. From the pole figures we can obtain orientation distribution function or Euler space and inverse pole figure and further information regarding texture. This method uses normal X-ray diffraction technique. It could be a neutron diffraction, it could be a synchrotron X-ray method, this could be an ultrasonic testing method too. It gives an qualitative information. On the other hand, microtexture. Microtexture, you can say local texture. It is a localized version of texture and it gives a very nice graphical representation. As I said in the previous class, that a full texture representation could be given by 6 parameter, that is phi 1, phi 2, x 1, x 2, x 3. The microtexture gives information about not only the orientation of a certain point in the microstructure, but it also gives from which position this orientation has been obtained, that is x 1, x 2, x 3, right. So, in microtexture what is done? It is basically measured in a electron gun, that is a scanning electron microscope, or in a transmission electron microscope. Mostly it is done in a scanning electron microscope with an attachment which is known as an EBSD attachment, electron backscatter diffraction attachment. It uses the same principle of diffraction but with an electron beam, and an area is selected in the microstructure in a sample, and the electron beam is pointed at a certain position. The information of the orientation is obtained in terms of Kikuchi diffraction pattern. I will come into detail. And then from this Kikuchi diffraction pattern, Euler angles, pole figures, inverse pole figures could be calculated mathematically. The software does that. And then the electron beam moves to the second position. So, it is a spot by spot scanning of the part of the sample to obtain the phi 1, phi 2 information from every spot, and it rasters the part of the microstructure that we want to scan, and we get the information of phi 1, phi 2 and x 1, x 2, x 3. So that, not x 3 of course, because we do not go depth unless and until we use EBSD with a fib attachment. So, we can do, we will come to later. So, what we do, we get information from this point, this point, this point, this point, and we go ahead rastering whole point, and thereby we get the whole information about the microstructure, the orientation, the grain size, the grain size distribution, everything, the misorientation angle distribution. And if we are using an FIB, we can scan one surface, take it to the ion milling, we can ion mill say 0.1 micrometer depth and go back and take another scan and go back to ion mill and do another 1 micrometer cleaning and go back again, and thereby we can generate a 3D microstructure, right? But it's really a cumbersome job. It takes a whole lot of time, and many times it people faces a lot of difficulty doing it, but it's fine. So in the microstructure measurement, that's what I am saying, is that we can get the information of the microstructure. So it's a computer generated, software generated microstructure, which is exactly the same as the original one, what we can get from the scanning electron microscope in the same spot. And from that, one can get the information about the texture. Say from the position 1, we know that the unit cell is like this with respect to the sample reference frame. Say this is RD and this is TD, and the ND is like this. So in the position 2, we get unit cell like that. And so in various positions, we know that how each grains are oriented with respect to the specimen reference frame. So X-ray diffraction, a normal X-ray diffraction method, gives a penetration depth of few micrometer, right? So this is the most major method throughout the world that is being used to carry out bulk texture measurement. The other method is a neutron diffraction method. In the neutron diffraction method, the measurement of bulk texture could be obtained from up to 1 centimeter of depth, because the intensity of the neutron diffraction is very high. The point is, we can get such information, such specialized information from the neutron diffraction that is not possible to obtain in normal X-rays. Because even though the X-rays goes up to 1 micrometer of the depth, but still it is very near to the surface. But in neutron diffraction, we can go well below depth in the surface, up to 1 centimeter, to obtain the X-ray texture information. Synchrotron X-ray method is another very important way to carry out texture measurement. This high intensity X-ray beam is used because this high intensified X-ray beam can go up to a depth of about 1 mm, and therefore a industrial sample, or say for example a rolled material or an extruded material or a complex material being developed, for example a specialized piston developed, one can, of course we will have to destruct the specimen, but still we can have various positions. You can put it in the synchrotron X-ray diffraction and see that how the texture is varying, the heterogeneity intertexture from one position to another with very high accuracy than any other method. Okay. So ultrasonic methods are basically normal cost effective methods which are used in industries as the sample is coming out in a continuous manufacturing process to see whether the texture that they want to produce has been produced or not. So they know it's a qualitative measurement, and they know that which intensity will be seen if the desired texture has been obtained. And if the desired texture is not obtained, the intensity will be different or it will be low, and that's how they do it. So very important to understand that electron backscatter diffraction, we use electron beams. The penetration depth of the electron beams are just few nanometers, and because of this very low penetration depth and because the area scanned in the is also very small, the measurements that are obtained may not be the representative information of the whole sample, and therefore it is always known as microtexture measurement. Okay. However, the thing is that in case of EBSD, we get a complete information, right? Phi 1, phi 2, x 1, x 2 and x 3, which we do not get from XRD. XRD we do not know, we only know that the overall texture of the material, but we do not know that in which position what texture is present. right? So, okay. So here you see that I have compared the wavelength, energy and charge and the mass for different neutron, X-ray and electrons, and you can see that, see, neutrons and X-rays have this almost the same wavelength, whereas the energy of X-rays are very high as compared to the neutron. The mass of the neutron is quite, and there is no mass in the X-ray. The penetration depth goes to from 1 centimeter to 10 centimeter in neutron diffraction depending upon the intensity, whereas the X-rays can go from about 0.01 mm, that is few micrometer, to some millimeter depth, and that is because of synchrotron X-rays, high intensified X-rays. In case of electron, the depth is very, very small, right? So, I am just coming into texture measurements by X-ray, which is very important, and I think that you are all waiting for this to know how we measure texture in an X-ray. In order to measure texture, the sample has to be placed in a 4-axis texture goniometer. So, the texture instrument, sorry, the X-ray instrument should have a 4-axis goniometer. Sometimes it is an extra attachment that you can buy later. Okay. So, the thing is that the sample has to be put, say for example, like this. I will just draw it. Okay. So, for example, if I put the sample like this in the X-ray, such that, so remember that before we put the sample, we have to find out that which HKL plane we want to see. So, initially we just do a theta to theta scan in order to get various intensities positions. So, we know that this theta 1 is for H1K1L1, for H2K2L2 and so on, right? And thereby, say for example, we set the diffractive, the X-ray diffraction beam in order to obtain diffraction for this particular HKL plane. So, we will fix the sample and the cathode ray tube in such a way at, say for example, theta 1 and the detector at 2 theta in order to get the diffraction from the HKL plane, right? We will keep the sample in such a way, usually I will say we keep the rolling direction like this, the normal direction is like this, and the transverse direction is like this. So, the normal direction is kept in such a way so that it bisects the incident and the diffraction beam following Bragg's Brentano geometry. Okay. Now, what we will do, if the incident beam falls in a sample when it is kept in such a position, then if there is a diffraction pattern obtained here, diffracted beam obtained here, this reflects those planes which are parallel to the rolling plane, right? That is perpendicular to the ND. If there is certain H1K1 L1 plane which is perpendicular to the ND at this position, the diffraction will occur, right? If there is no H1K1 L1 plane which is perpendicular to the ND, then there will be no diffraction. So, one can represent this on a pole figure. So, in the pole figure, if I am keeping this as ND, and this RD, if I am keeping it here, and if I am keeping, okay, sorry, if I am keeping this as TD, then this becomes RD. Just I am keeping this TD, so RD is there. So, where I am, when the incident beam is falling and the diffraction beam is going to the detector, I am at this position, right, at ND. So any H1K1 plane, if there is, it is present in ND, will get diffract. If it is not present, then it won't. So depending upon that, we will get intensity, either we will get or we will not get, right. So say for example, if I rotate along ND by 360 degrees in this position, what will happen? The material will rotate, the material will rotate, right? It will rotate like this. But the HKL planes will be either, if it is perpendicular initially, it will remain perpendicular and there will be no effect, right? So even if you rotate, if you get a diffraction, you will get initially. If there is no diffraction, you will not get. Now, but the second thing is that if we keep another rotation, which is an alpha rotation, okay, so this rotation is known as beta rotation, this is known as the alpha rotation. This rotation is along TD. If I rotate by alpha by say 5 degrees at first, what will happen? That means initially the sample is looking like this. Now it will look little tilted, right? So it will get tilted, right, by 5 degrees. I hope that I am able to make you imagine that how it looks tilted. When it looks, when it is tilted, the ND becomes like this, right? Whereas the incident beam, whereas the vector bisecting the incident beam will remain at certain angle to the ND, right? But you should remember that the ND should be in a line with the bisector of this incident and the diffracted beam, so that every time we rotate the sample, so it is something like that, that if I have a circle here, a tube kind of circle here, all the time the bisector of the incident beam and the reflector beam and the ND of the specimen should point towards the radial direction of that circle. And if it does like that, then it is following the Bragg-Brentano's geometry, and then only the feasible diffraction is possible. Now what I am doing is that I have rotated by 5 degrees, and when I am rotating along TD by 5 degrees, what I am doing, that means I am taking this, I am keeping it here, right? So now we are measuring the H1, K1, L1 plane comprising which are not perpendicular to the ND, but is perpendicular to 5 degrees than ND, right? And that is the vector which is the bisector of the incident beam and the diffraction beam, right? So, and this position is not at the center, is just 5 degrees away from the center. Under such situation, if the HKL planes are present, then you will get some intensity. However, now we rotate by beta by 360 again, and in certain, in that case, we are rotating beta like this. We will repeat the experiment depending upon how much you want to use alpha, 5 degree or 2.5 degree. It will increase the resolution of the result. And so we will go ahead again 5 degrees and do a scan, and go ahead and do a scan, and we continue to do the scan until we keep on get it. But you remember that after some point, after we go to alpha is equal to something like 70 degrees or 65, 67 degrees, you will not get very nice reflections, and I will come to it rather later. And because you see, then it becomes something like this, the sample is now like this and the incident beam is coming and it's just glancing the sample, it will go back, go in a straight line, right? So it will not give a proper diffraction, because now instead of having an incident beam initially which has a spot like this, it has a very big spot. We will come to it later. So we measure for a particular HKL plane, and we measure the intensity points, and maybe it will come somewhere here and here and here. But as we cannot measure greater than 70 degrees along alpha, what we do is that we measure one H1 K1 L1 plane, and then we change the value of theta and measure another H2 K2 L2 plane, and all we are measuring up to 70 degrees, right? And then we go to another, we measure H3 K3 L3 plane, like we do 3-4 times depending upon the symmetry of the crystal and the deformation, and we get 3 or 4 different pole figures, right? Pole figures. Say for example, as I said, in case of FCC we will get like 110, 200, 220 and maybe another, and all up to 70 degrees. So incomplete pole figures, so you will get 3 or 4 incomplete pole figures. And once we get this incomplete pole figures, why we need the other pole figures? Because we need the information which is here, and this may be obtained from the other pole figure. So we use calculations, we calculate, we put the 4 pole figures, we calculate, and then we get obtain the calculated pole figure. The calculated pole figure has information of all HKL planes up to 90 degrees, okay? And then from that we can calculate the phi 1, phi 2, we can calculate the orientation matrices, we can find out the Miller indices and all, okay? So here I am showing just 2 figures. One is how the diffraction could be obtained in a goniometer in a transmission mode, and another in the reflection mode. A transmission mode is only possible in neutron diffraction, synchrotron diffraction, right, where the intensities of the rays are very high, where it can be transmitted. In case of normal X-rays that we use in our laboratories, we keep it in the reflection mode. Remember, don't get confused by the name reflection. There is no reflection occurring here, right? It's just a name to show its transmission and in reflection, okay? So you see that with respect to ND, there is a rotation phi. So the phi rotation in the ND, you can see the position of the sample which is kept, ND is like this, TD is like that, and RD is like that. The phi rotation in the ND is basically the beta rotation that we are giving. The xi rotation along TD, you can see there is a xi rotation along TD, is basically the alpha rotation. Basically the relationship between the xi rotation and the alpha rotation is xi is equal to 90 degree minus alpha. This is just because of the geometry of the instrument that we use, okay? So there are other rotations. You see the RD is kept W. The W or the omega basically determines the theta, which is always kept constant. So when the theta is kept constant, the W is made the omega is made 0. Okay. The another angle here is the 2 theta or the theta. So, we have 4 angles, right? Theta, which is kept fixed, it is kept fixed at a position so that you make the omega 0, and then we rotate by this zeta, which is equivalent to 90 minus alpha by 2.5 degree or 5 degree steps, and then this phi, which is equivalent to the beta, which we rotate by 360 degrees slowly in every 2.5 degree alpha or 5 degree beta, 5 degree alpha, right. Similarly, this can be done for the transmission mode. Here is a picture of a very old texture galvanometer from the Institute of Metal Kunde and Metal Physics in RW2H Aachen. You know, this institute is in Germany, is one of the pioneering institute in doing texture and related works, right, and initiated by Gunther Gottstein, is still active in doing research, but is basically retired. So, that's what I was saying. You see, there is an X-ray source, there is a horizontal slit, a vertical slit. Basically, we want to take away all the polychromatic radiation and keep the monochromatic K alpha. And you see that there is a divergent X-ray, right? The normal X-rays are not parallel, they are always divergent. Okay? Only synchrotron X-rays, we can make it little parallel, so its intensity remains very high, right? And then there is a diffraction or scattering going on, and again the receiving slit and anti-scattering slit and the detector. You can see that theta and 2 theta is been maintained between the X-ray source and the detector. You can see that the sample is been rotated and the ND is just away from the K, which is the bisector of the incident and the reflected beam. And you should always remember that K and ND should be in such a position that it should lie in this circle as a radius of this circle. So that the Bragg-Brentano's geometry is always maintained. Okay? So, this method is known as Schulze reflection method, right? In the Schulze reflection method, there is a rotation of alpha along one axis, which is basically the TD. There is a rotation of beta along another axis, which is basically ND, and there is a translational motion in order to have more area into consideration while taking this information, right? So, initially the information they used to take was using a motor which used to rotate to obtain a spiral like this. But with the advent of new technologies, as I was explaining to you, this is a pole figure, okay, and I am showing the alpha and beta rotation. Okay. So, I am sorry. So, you can see that nowadays what we do, we take alpha and then rotate 360 degree beta, and you take another alpha, we again rotate by 360 degree beta, take another alpha, we again, and like that we try to do to measure the whole pole figure, which is analogous to the stereographic projection, right? But in this case, we have the reference system as RD, TD and ND.